A very good afternoon to all the dignitaries present on the dais and my fellow companions. I, Genia Jain, a student manager of Balaji Institute of International Business, feels privileged to introduce you all the dynamic personality, Mr. Shailendra Abhyankar, an innovative leader. Sir has a wide range of working experience in companies like CDOT, TCS, and SunGard, with an overall working span of 28 years. Presently, Sir is Innovation Leader, India, and Technology Head, Pune, for BNY Mellon. Now, I request Shailendra Sir to guide us through his knowledge and experience. Sir, the dais is all yours.
Hi, good afternoon. Good. You're all very well dressed. I'm on a Sunday, so I'm in a half sleeve shirt. So, I have been told to talk about guiding you into the 21st century. And, you know, what I thought is very interesting because I'll speak around the fintech world. And this word fintech is fairly new. While I'll go down some history as to, you know, why it is important to understand what we did in the past to understand what is the future. The two are sort of finance and technology were two separate things because finance has lived ever since mankind was born. There was some form of money. In the beginning, it was some leather and stuff like that. But there was some form of monetizing things. So if you look, finance is a very old field, whereas technology is something seen as new age. So it's a very powerful combination of the old and new. And that's how every time I see life is. Because you can't throw away what is old and take everything what is new. So it's a very, very powerful combination. Sometimes logical, sometimes not logical, sometimes rational, sometimes not rational. So I'll start with telling you what finance is all about in about 5 or 10 minutes. But it's not something you will get in books. So I'm not going to tell you about debit credits and all of that which you guys learn. I'll tell you some very basic notions around finance. So what do you do in finance? There are three things you must remember. So three entities in finance. One is time. Why do you say time? When you are in finance, what do you want to do? You want to look at value of money over time, and hopefully it increases, correct? For all of us. So that's really, really important, the notion of time. And what do you do to increase the value of money over time? You invest that money somewhere. And the only way, let's say you put it into a manufacturing industry, that's the easiest old age industry that you know. How will you increase the value of that money? The only way you can really increase the value of that money is to produce more, correct? So your productivity is higher and at a lower cost. So if you really want your money to get 5 times, then your productivity curve along with the cost curve should be in that direction, correct? All of you get that? But people are ingenious. People want that money to grow much faster than a normal curve. And that's where finance, the beauty of finance comes in. And then I'll tell you how technology adds some more dimensions to it. So if you want to grow your money, all you have, the correct way to do it is, if I have to grow my money, I put it into some vehicle of which I call an investment vehicle, which could be, let's say, a manufacturing industry. And for that money to grow, my production and my rate of return must match, correct? That's the traditional financial way. But everybody, there's greed involved in money. Rightly and wrongly, all of us, because all of us have ambitious goals. And when I say greed, don't take it wrongly. Unless we are all strive to do much beyond what we can do, we will not grow fast. So there is some greed for doing things. And so what happens? So you try to get ahead of the curve. So there's a curve, correct? Your growth curve. And you want more than that. So how do you try to get ahead of the curve? Finance has a nice way of saying something called leverage. I don't know how many of you are from finance background here. So you put something called leverage into it. And leverage means that you are actually outpacing the actual growth to get to where you are. So it's things like you don't have, correct? Leverage means you don't have that, but I'm putting some more, infusing some more capital. So this is where the funny race starts. And I call it funny because leverage is a very important word. Now add technology to it. If you add technology into the mix, you will get some very interesting things. One is two different perspectives. The way you grow money is by that curve, the regular way, and you can outbeat that curve by putting a leverage. And you will outbeat it for a while, and then you get a bubble, and then it goes back in again because you've gone ahead of something. So you get a bubble at some point because you've stretched yourself beyond the realm of reality. Correct? So you get a financial bubble. And that bubble at some point will burst. All of you hear that word bubble. Bubble means you are really living in an incorrect world because your productivity is at this stage, but you have actually stretched yourself through a leverage, which is financial leverage. It's funny money. It's not reality. Money is all virtual. So in that sense, the combination of technology and finance is extremely powerful. We both are virtual worlds. It's all digitized or, you know, it's all in the banks. You get some notes, and with demonetization, you know what happened. But so that is one aspect. But if you really combine technology with it, then you get another aspect. The aspect that has come recently in the last few years is it's not all about productivity. So you start saying because of technology, it's also all about number of eyeballs and stuff like that. So you get a different connotation coming in. So your whole value of money is not related to simple things like in life, which are, if I do something, I do it better, then I get more money. I do it more efficiently, which is the basic principles. And suddenly you get a different paradigm. I don't need to do it better, but if I can attract more people, I don't care whether I make money or not, then my money can get multiplied. But that's really the first part, the time notion of money. The second part I see is with technology, the notion of time, because earlier your notion of time was in 6 months, 1 year. Actually today with technology, people are, the notion of time has shrunk quite a lot. So the time in which you can make money, if you go around is, could be a day, half a day, could be a minute, could be a millisecond, because if you're in trading, you can actually make money through high frequency trading in few seconds. So the time notion of money has changed quite a lot with technology. But that's the first principle of finance, time and how you multiply your money through time and the fact that leverage plays an important part there. The second feature of finance is you got to do that, you need to look at what we call chance or probability. Because every time you bet on something, correct, it's statistical. I mean, I'm not saying it's a punt. But it is statistical that you tomorrow, you put your money somewhere, you want it to grow. You really want to look at the probability that it will happen. Because everywhere you take markets and everything is based on perception, correct? Everywhere you have. So where does technology come in here? Technology comes in here because of two things. Everything you do in taking a chance is statistical. And, you know, technology has made that statistic simple. One is the simple way. But also there is all this gut feel. And with the new world, with artificial intelligence, that's also going to sort of be very, very important. So technology, again, marries this second concept of time, probability, and the third is what I call markets. So you have a time notion of money. You have a probability model along with it. And then you have a marketplace. Now, the marketplace is really the biggest thing. Because what you do with the marketplace is you get everybody involved into money. It's not necessarily people who want to do manufacturing or anybody. And that's where the beauty is. So it becomes a world which is not a world of people who know what they want. It is the herd mentality. And the markets is really the biggest thing that sort of can create, destroy wealth. And if you know, the first marketplace, because you have markets for many things. You have markets like Amazon for buying things, or Flipkarts, or Snapdeals. But the first electronic marketplace was for was the NASDAQ, and that's quite old. It's many years ago. So what you see today has happened in the financial world much earlier, and the reason was you get more people involved, because when you take a chance or a probability, you have a risk, correct? Every time you say, I want to grow my money, there's a time I want to grow it in, then I say there is a risk, or you know, then I say probability of that happening, that means there's a risk. Anytime you say probability, it's not certain. That means there's an element of risk. The best way to take out that risk is spread that risk around thousands of people, thousands, millions of people, and many of them don't even know what the hell they're doing. So it becomes that marketplace gives you that risk, leveraging of, deleveraging of risk that happens. So this is really finance, and it's only possible because of the reach that technology can provide, and the fact that most markets are then electronic, you don't need to know who the other person is. So technology and finance, in some sense, are intertwined in the growth phase. And there are goods and bads to it. So I thought, you know, these three concepts you should always learn. Forget about accounting and debit credit, but the time value of money. Finance has this principle that somehow you make money, and money is virtual. So you always want to make money without doing anything in some sense. And that's why you trade. You get many people involved in trading, and most of them don't know what it means. That's the principle. Because you're de-risking, but there are lots of people buying. It's like today the real estate industry. Most people are buying real estate not to live. It's an investment vehicle. They don't really know. Everybody's telling, my friend bought a flat here. Hey, this, you know, he made so much money, I'll also go and buy. You don't need it. And that's really where the market outpaces itself. So I'll give you some more history. And then we'll come to, you know, how it's changing and guiding you into the 21st century. So if I give you some history, I don't know if you, how many of you heard about the tulip story in Netherlands? Have you, any of you have sort of aware of what happened in the 16th century? No? So all of you know that tulips are beautiful flowers. And in the 16th century, this was really the precursor to the whole markets. In the 16th century, believe me, one tulip is just a flower, was being sold for about 15 years of salary of an skilled artisan, which was in guilders at that point. There was no euro then. So it was clearly the biggest bubble that ever happened. The reason was very interesting. It's a market phenomenon. And what happened was tulips were not in Europe. They were never in Holland. Tulips actually were grown in Central Asia. Afghanistan, Kazakhstan, these are the places where parts where tulips were being grown. And they were brought into Holland at that time, and people loved it. So there was a demand and supply issue in some sense, which, and then the French came, and the French sort of, you know, started liking the flower so much that they started trading in it. And at some point, it happened like the stock markets or the real estate. Somewhere the cost of the tulip became so high that somebody said, now I can't sell it. So what do? You can buy a part of it, or you can buy like a derivative. That's when the first derivative instrument came. A bulb, you can buy a bulb. It's not even the tulip flower. The bulb is actually the plant that will give a flower in the end. So that's when people who never really bothered about anything to do with tulips started trading in tulips. And the cost just zoomed. Because it was all money to leverage. So people started having an option on tulip. People started coming out with a derivative on tulip. This is all happening without any market there. But this is really what was happening. And it was people, so nobody bothered about what the hell the tulip was. Everybody bothered about it like, this is the way I can make money. And what really happened is one fine day, somebody pulled the plug because there's physical reality in it, and the market collapsed. And it was, if you go and talk to any Dutchman, they laugh about it, because can you believe a Dutch person paying that much for tulips at that point of time? But this was actually the first known financial bubble in the Western world. And the only reason it was known was that you could take something which was attractive to a few, monetize that, and take it to the masses in some way. And if you take it to the masses, and the masses don't look at it as a vehicle for what the tulip meant, the masses looked at it as a way of making money. So they didn't really care whether it was a tulip at the bottom, whether it was a tulip with a nice... They had nice things. Actually, at that point, the funny story was that there was a virus and the tulip, because of that virus, some of the tulips started getting some nice colors. And they were actually costing much more, although it was a virus-infected tulip. So really, people didn't care. But it was the markets that were making it go crazy. And it was a reach without having electronification. I bet you if you had technology then, the whole world could have been, or at least the whole Western world could have been in this tulip craze. And it could have crashed the economy even more. The other financial innovation, which is, I will go back to history, and I'm telling you this because it's very interesting, because all of you know finance in a very different way. The other interesting piece is the biggest financial innovation. I'm coming to innovation in finance and innovation in technology, and how they marry each other and feed each other. So the biggest financial innovation happened when everyone wanted to conquer the world, correct? There were the Portuguese Armada and the British people were all over. So you know the East India Company. It was a South Sea Company before that, but it was an East India Company. And you know the East India Company conquered India, not the British, the company. And the only reason East India Company became so powerful was because of a concept which came in the financial world fairly, you know, just before East India Company was formed by the Queen's decree, was a limited liability company. What does that mean? A limited liability company is a great way to raise money. In the past, if you had ownership on a company, whether it's part, bit, if something goes wrong with the company, you are fully liable to anything because you are an owner. Now, with a limited liability, what they said is you will get some dividends, all your liability is for that little peanut share that you have, and nothing else beyond that. Sounds logical, but what that meant is they could monetize the whole thing and go and conquer the world, because all they went and sold everybody is buy a share of East India Company. And East India Company, believe me, is the one that really conquered India, not the British. They came to Calcutta, and the reason they could do this was the amount of capital they could raise through a simple financial innovation called limited liability company. It did not exist before that. There was South Sea and others, some of these had failed. So that's really some of the financial innovations. All the financial innovation today is around asset classes. And today, asset classes could be things like selling esoteric things. So the way it works is, with all this came also regulation. So asset classes came, in a sense, do you buy commodity, do you buy equity, do you buy derivatives, we talked about it. And now people buy alternate investments, which is like things like wine, art. And the reason they will sell art is not you and me who are connoisseurs of art. I may not be, I'm just saying. They will commoditize. The moment it gets wild and expensive, then it means that people are not interested in art. People are interested in making money, period. And that happens to every asset class. Because that's the only way the financial cycle can feed each other. One goes, the other comes. Starts with tulips, I told you. And tulips really set up the whole thing. Now it starts with companies. I mean, a lot of us buy shares, and I don't even know what the company does many times. We know a little bit. Who cares, correct? We're in it not because of, we just want to make money. We buy real estate, a lot of us, because we just want to make money. We're probably not going to stay there. We might rent it because there's an interim period. So that's really what is happening in this crazy financial world. It'll be art, it'll be wine. You don't need to be a wine connoisseur. You don't need to be an art connoisseur. All you will do is you want to make money. And as you make that whole thing open to the world, unlimited possibilities. In fact, when you have people who don't know about art, you can fool them more. So this is where the vicious cycle and that reach. So the reach is good and bad. I'm not saying technology plays a bad part in it, but it de-risks everything. And this is really where the fintech world is playing a huge part. Now, coming to technology, I'll give you some, because you got the three principles of finance: time, chance or probability, and then, like I said, market reach or markets. And then the fourth one comes regulation, which is a new phenomenon, because people started realizing that sometimes greed is outrunning reality. And then, you know, you got this whole thing called a regulation. But regulation will allow, so people find opportunities before a regulation comes. So what is regulated today? You have in India SEBI, correct? What do they regulate? They regulate equities, they regulate options, they regulate derivatives, they regulate commodities, but they don't regulate things like art and wine and till now real estate was not. So these are asset classes that have a normally higher bubble. And then when it gets regulated, it sort of calms down. But you'll always find new things. People are trading weather, by the way. If you go to, you know, the US, and you have indexes on weather. How different is it from, but then there are lots of people who want weather. The industry is dependent on the weather cycles. So it's not completely wrong. But the industry is wanting it, but the people who trade on it are really hardly don't care. They just want to make money. So that's the financial cycle. Now coming to technology. So if you look at technology, we've gone through, I told you some history of finance, and finance is a very old field. Technology is reasonably new, and we talk about, you know, and the reason it got married to finance is fairly obvious. Finance is all about money. Money is all about numbers. What did computers do when they started off? All they did was number crunching. So clearly there was a easy marriage of convenience that these two, if I do together, I can do my number crunching faster, I can, and then the reach. I told you the other part of the reach. I can do my statistical calculations, everything, you know, what I want to do. Whether it's a bank or whether it's a personal trader, everybody started looking at computing for automating a lot of things. But if you look at computing, it has gone through three or four cycles. First was, you know, just the evolution of computers. Then came personal computers because it came onto your desktops. Then came the internet age. Then came social media and all the smack, IoT, cloud, whatever you call it. But all this has happened during 100 years. And each of these have made the finance industry leapfrog 10 times, many times. So if you can see the world, how it is really, really working on that principle of if you combine traditional finance with technology, it's an implosive effect. I mean, the whole thing really, when I say, sorry, it sort of implodes or explodes depending on the way you see it. I use both words. Explodes is more positive. Implodes might be more negative or the other way around. But you really get the biggest transformation that you can. And that is quite important. So here is what I wanted to now say as to what really happened. So we talked about tulips, we talked about limited liability, and we talked about coming more to the near past. And I'm taking negative examples, but if you see the tulips happened many years ago, the 2008 crash happened many, many years after that. So technology has really helped control things, and but you still have aberrations. So what really happened in 2008? What and why couldn't technology control it? What happened in 2008 was everything was on a high because it was all, you were getting loans in the US in particular. What was happening is anybody, I mean, let's say somebody like you who's just finished, you know, his MBA, has no, just got into a job in 3 months, you could go to a bank because the economy was booming. You could go to a bank and say, I want to buy a house. And they'd give you loans without really scrutinizing your history. And what were they doing? And this was because everybody, there was lots of money in the system. The banks had more money and they wanted to give it away. Great position to be in for the banks because the banks had enough money to give to people, and they felt that somebody who's, you know, got an MBA with 2 months of experience might just be the right guy. It wasn't that way in the past. And what were they doing? They'll take money from all of you. They knew it was a risk. And what did they do with that? They would collateralize all of that. What that means is all the money they would take, and then they would add, they would make it into small bits and pieces and sell you something which was like a mortgage-backed security. And they would tranche it. There's some good money, there's some bad money, they'll put it all together and say this is, the rating agencies were also hand in glove. So it would come out as double A rated, triple A rated. Because what did you do? You put some good with the bad, mixed it up, and only the tranche was sort of being seen, the good was being seen and the top. So it was gamed, of course. I mean, the rating agencies were clearly also hand in glove at that point. I mean, never proved, but they're not fools. And what happened? At some point, the bubble exploded. So you went, because of this, you went ahead. You went ahead of what? So this is the whole leverage concept. You started giving loans beyond people's means. Coming back to that leverage concept that I just told you in the beginning. And then the bubble exploded. And, you know, no amount of technology would have stopped that because it was being done by people systematically. So this is another example in the recent past of how the fintech industry grows. But this is how it will grow. You will have a boom, you will have a bust, you will again have a boom, and you will always grow faster than what is reality. Remember that. So don't think what I'm saying is wrong. If you want to make it in the finance world, you have to stretch beyond reality. Otherwise, don't take the risk of being in the financial world. You can be an accountant. When I say financial world, if you want to make that jump of taking your current value of money and growing it over time, taking a chance, going into a marketplace, if that's what the definition of finance is, you will have to play this game. If your definition of finance is, I want to be a bookkeeping accountant, very safe. If your definition of finance is, I want to, you know, go back and be a chartered accountant and evaluate someone's books, very safe. But if your real notion of making money is to, you have to understand these three phenomena in life. Now, what is happening in the technology world again? So if you go back, this combination is extremely, extremely potent. You know, when you see technology and when you see finance and they sort of melting down together, you see very interesting things that are happening. One is what we call in the financial world, you've always had intermediaries. It's there in every world. What's a broker, correct? If you go to a real estate market, you have a broker, correct? Somebody who's in between, correct? A broker, what does he do? He matches a buy and a sell. Now, of course, with electronic marketplaces, that broker is going away somewhere. You're seeing it even in your shopkeeper is going away. He's a broker, correct? He takes it from a manufacturer, displays it in his shop. You go there, you buy it. He's a broker in some sense. I mean, whatever the word is, he's a shopkeeper in all. It's an honorable profession, but it's been there. Even in the financial world, you have the whole thing is getting disintermediated in some sense. So there's a big opportunity within finance and tech because of the reach that you don't need this person in between. The other part which people are seeing is democratization. And this is a very interesting word again. Democratization sounds very nice. You hear everybody, Prime Minister Modi saying also, financial inclusion. It's got a bad side too. You're getting everybody into finance, everybody into bank accounts. You want everybody in the stock market. You're doing some yojana, correct? To get, I don't know what the name is, whether it's Rajiv Gandhi or there's a yojana which is announced so that people can trade. But what are you trying to do? You're trying to get people who don't know anything about the financial markets to come into the market, to be fools like all of us, so that somebody else can make money. That is the principle of finance. When you get to a marketplace, you don't, like I said in the past, tulips were put into the marketplace not because somebody understood tulips. It became a vehicle to make money. Similarly, when you go into the real estate markets, half the people don't really care whether they're going to stay in the house. It is their vehicle to make money. Moment you do financial inclusion, the bad part is also this, that everybody gets into the banking system, which is great for the banks, which is great for everybody, but some of them will be caught into this nebulous world of trying to be trading or doing things which they don't know anything about and which will make money for the next biggest financial cycle. So that's really what is happening. If you see financial inclusion or democratization is getting finance to everybody, which sounds very noble, and it is, that everybody now will save. But the human mentality is, we don't want to save, we want to save more than what, or I want to get more money. Saving seems like, okay, yaar bank mein paisa dalunga to abhi 3 tak kabhi vyaj nahi milta hai. Let me put it somewhere else, correct? So let me go to the stock market, let me go to mutual funds. Why are the mutual funds so high today? Nobody's putting money in the bank. They want, their bank is giving them 3% unless you go to Kotak or something that says 6%. Everybody is wanting to put it in some fund. It's not because, and why is the market so high? It's not because the industry is doing so well. It is really because of the fact that there's too much money in the markets. And somebody else is making the markets for you. If the mutual funds and LIC and everybody has so much money, the industry will look good. Because nobody wants to crash. Whose party is going to be stopped? So this is really the cycle that is happening. And technology can actually play a role to grow this and to arrest it, both. So I'm coming to that fintech world. And it is happening. So, and it's not bad. These are things in life that will happen. So I'm not making a statement here whether right or wrong. But you see, this is again a recent phenomenon when I say democratization, financial inclusion, disintermediation, all of these are trends that are happening. Peer-to-peer lending, again, is a way of getting out of any intermediary. So you have money, I have money, we are connected on social media through a peer-to-peer lender. I don't need a bank, correct? So that is really what peer-to-peer. So the banks are also getting a bit disrupted by this. But then that could also mean that what's the probability? So I don't know you, you don't know me. I borrow from you, what's the chance that I will lend back or I'll give it back? There's a risk. But then this is like there's no middleman involved. So all the overheads of middlemen are gone. So technically what you get is you can give your money at a higher loan, higher interest rate, and the other person actually gets it at a lower interest rate, which sounds funny, correct? But that is because you don't have that middle person. So technology is doing all of this, peer-to-peer lending. It's like the Uber model in some sense, correct? I have my car. In India, you can't do it. But in the US and other places, if I have my car, I can just sign up for Uber. And in the evening, I can go and ply my car as an Uber car. And anybody can sort of, your Airbnb model. So everywhere, this disintermediation is happening, which is actually very good. There's a risk to it, though. But unless you take risk, money won't grow. So that's the whole premise of finance. And technology can help you manage that risk very, very strongly. So really, this is something around the fintech world. And I talk more on finance because I think, you know, all of you know, I'm a hardcore technologist and I can take questions. But I think a lot of people are enamored by technology these days because you see it everywhere. People call it ambient computing. So if you heard Sundar Pichai the other day on NDTV, ambient computing. What is ambient computing? That means computing is there everywhere you go. I'm sitting here, I'll know what is happening. For example, today morning when I got up, I looked at my phone. Every day now it tells me your driving time automatically. I don't need to do anything, correct? You guys must have seen it. When I go from my house to my work, in the morning it tells me your drive time is 25 minutes, as long as you give it access. When you get up in the morning, it tells you chance of rain. It's telling you things without actually asking for it. So computing is becoming ambient everywhere. And what that means is a fundamental change. Now I'll come to the pieces that impact all of you. It's all of you now. The IT industry has been a very big employer. And we've always thrived with lots of managers, lots of leaders. We've been sort of seen as the biggest growing industry for many years. And now you hear different stories. So I want to demystify that a little bit, because now you hear different stories that, oh, you know, is the TCS party over, or, you know, is Infosys going to do well? What's really happening in the world? They're not hiring. They're not going to campuses. All of it, you know, correct? I mean, so why is this happening? And there's a good side to it, because I think really this is just the natural evolution and we will hit the next stage. So if you look what is happening now, coming back to your careers in India, talk to you on finance and talk to you on technology, I want to bring you down to ground here. So what's really happening? First, if you look, the technology industry is moving to be seen more and more as an IP-led industry versus a service industry. That's a big transformation that is happening all over us. Doesn't mean that service is not there, but people, now it is product-led services. So we used to sell plain vanilla services. Everybody used to buy custom stuff. Now, unless you are in some native, you know, piece of technology, what is happening is it's product-led services. So what do you do? What do you know product-led services? You build around your IP. You don't kind of do custom stuff, just come and do a complete system for anybody. But that's one change that is happening. Good and bad, because India has been more services, and in the Indian economy itself, services grows much faster than any other industry, manufacturing or agriculture, or and services has been the pillar of India in some sense. Whether it's hotels, whether it's financial services, whether it's technology, everything was driven by services. And the human quotient, you know, that we have so much demographic dividend here that we have positive for us, that I think services was seen as a big, strong differentiator for the Indian economy. Now, some changes are happening there. So I told you that at least in technology, everything is going very much towards a picture where we are IP-led. Second, it's not all so bad, because when it's IP-led, I know the challenge that India used to have is, I can make a product, but it's very hard for me to sell it in the Western markets because it's goddamn expensive, correct? I don't have, marketing and sales cost you more money than R&D, it's very clear. If you go to a company, the guys who make the most money are the sales guys, because they really sell. And that's what the end product, they're the last mile, correct? And if you want to sell in the US or if you want to sell in the Western markets, it costs you a lot of money. Now, two things have happened. One is the Indian market is waking up to reality. So it's not all that bad. I mean, if you go, the Indian market has huge potential. And in the next 5 or 10 years, it might actually be bigger than many of the other markets here. And plus, with the opening up of technology, social media, and et cetera, it's easier to sell in the global markets because the world has globalized, correct? That's the second trend which I'm seeing. One is the IP-led, second is the local markets. The third trend is our technology industry has matured in a big way, and that is going to impact a lot of you. So I'll tell you what, when I say it's matured, we started doing technology in India, if you take like TCS, etc., because I've been part of that company for many years, 1968. And while, you know, compared to manufacturing or compared to the bank that I work in now, Bank of New York Mellon is probably 235 years old. So, you know, when I say TCS 68, it probably drops. But looking at technology itself is about a 100-year industry. If you take companies like TCS or other Indian software, just forget about companies, professionals, the maturity has now come to that stage, where 50, 60 years, you're no more. And so what's happening in the world? I'll tell you what is happening. So most large companies where you might seek employment, and particularly if they are multinational, whether it's Google, an Intel, Barclays, the Bank of New York Mellon, Adobe, any of these. So what's happening there? The old traditional way of working was that you have people in India, and it's a large set of people, because India was always sort of the second largest center anywhere outside of US was India. I don't think that used to be a big thing, but nobody even talks about it anymore because it's a given. Almost every company, you know, in IT or technology, if you take beyond US, and maybe in some like IBM, it's probably even higher in India. So the reason then, the challenge was because we were culturally different, the time zones were different at that time, the internet was not great, you know, 70s, 80s, 90s. So we started running our parallel culture. So we used to have a large team here with local managers on this side, another manager on that side, and they used to talk to each other, etc. It's all getting disrupted. Fundamentally, if the world is connected by technology, and the world runs 24/7, particularly in the financial industry, it does run 24/7. One stock market sleeps, the other one opens. You cannot live with duality of managers. You need one accountable person across the globe. So what that means is that, number one, the number of managers many times that are required in technology companies is reducing. So I wanted to give you the reason why. And I think the reason why is not because of anything else. In many cases in the MNCs, there's a maturity which is happening because the system now works across the globe, you need global accountability, and you don't need. The second thing is automation. Now, what could be done by, you know, number of people in the past is done by much smaller number of people. So you don't need as many. But at the same time, the rate at which you turn out software is very high. So for example, one of the things in the industry which people are looking at is, you know that cyber security is like really, really big. So when I say cyber security, there's always threat in the fintech world that somebody is going to hack in. Other day, I think Yahoo said everything was compromised from 2013. So all your emails, etc. are seen, correct? So cyber security is big. And if you look what happens in cyber security, every company now is worried while they are on the cloud and wherever. They're really worried. And why are they worried? They look at something called a vulnerability. A vulnerability means, what does a vulnerability mean? It really means that there's a loophole or a way to get into your system. Correct? Now, if you look at what that means is, today, in any given large company, the vulnerabilities are very, very high. They run into hundreds of thousands. And that's the job. That means you need to keep fixing those, patching things to make sure that your systems are safe and secure. But the beauty is that the rate at which new vulnerabilities are coming is much higher than the current vulnerabilities. So you can never, it's an unending race. You can never fix all the vulnerabilities. The reason being this ambient computing that I talked about. And which means that what is happening? Technology has been consumed so much that people are now releasing software every day. Every day you have a new release. And you have a principle of continuous delivery. Google will not only release every day, it builds its Google things every few minutes. It's continuously building and sending out new things. So you're always behind the latest now. Google, of course, is one where they just one Google. But companies are always churning out new software. And if you don't adopt the new software, you always expose a loophole or a vulnerability. So you're going to be behind time because the rate at which people are releasing software is extremely high and is being deployed almost continuously in many industries. May not be always. And to do that, I think what is happening is systematically, the way people are now working is not the traditional way of working, where very hierarchical, you have a manager, 5 team member, 10, 20 member team, you know, very structured. You have to really work at speed. So this whole concept of agile working is coming up. And agile really means that, again, if you look within agile, the teams are cross-functional, so you don't have the separation of this is quality engineering and this is development and maker-checker and all. I mean, there were good practices in the past. You need governance, correct? Somebody who codes should not be the one testing and all of that. But now they say everybody is an automation engineer. I don't care. And somebody functional at that some point will test it either way. So what is happening is you have this whole agile teams. And is really what agile means, it's cross-functional, self-organized, and is really no manager. There are managers at the top, but they're not going to be managing that 10% team. They might look at it in a broader sense. So what I'm trying to tell you is because of the pace at which things are moving, so one is, I'm seeing the maturity of the industry whereby now people have the potential to be global managers, but then the duality of having a manager in India and a manager in the US is still there, but is slowly sort of getting diminished. But with that, the beauty is everybody in India who is really stellar has the ability to be seen and heard globally. And you can see that. I mean, 30 years ago, I talked about 1968 TCS. Now, if you look, just look at the three or four largest technology companies in the US who are leading them, Satya Nadella, Sundar Pichai. So you can clearly see that what this means is for people in India who are managing things, they're going to be globally exposed and they have the opportunity to sort of be building their careers much faster. But at the same time, the number of such people who are going to be in leading positions might reduce. So that's the reality. There is a good side to it, but I know in India, a lot of things is based around volume. And because of automation, the industry is seeing their own automation back in now. The good part is there's so much automation outside that is happening that quite clearly, I mean, we still need huge number of sort of good people. But they have to be self-organizing teams, cross-functional teams, fully empowered, and the manager is only, you know, if you go to the conventional manager theory, you will have a manager who can be a coach, who can be an inspiring person, who can be a dictator when required. Now, with the agile way of working, the manager can never dictate. He can only motivate and lead at best. The dictation part is left with the team. So there are things that the manager now, the role of the manager is getting changed. The number of managers is getting disrupted. The type of managers that we need now is changing. So all of these are things that you should see in perspective as you build your career as future leaders in the fintech or technology industry. And again, the fact that technology is getting into every single domain, if you really want to be in the fintech domain, I think understanding that finance, the world of finance is very important, because the finance industry, believe me, has always, it's the one of the oldest industries around, because nothing lives without finance. And it's a virtual industry, like I said. Finance doesn't really manufacture anything. Even your notes are made by the government, but everything is plastic or digital right now. So if you combine finance and technology, they are very like industries. One old age, one new age, both virtual, and both sort of highly innovative. And I told you some of the financial innovations. They might sound small, but they have made the biggest impact anywhere in the world. So really, I think the career for someone in fintech is largely positive. But understanding the financial domain and orienting yourself as a manager or a leader in the context of what I just told you is absolutely important. So with this, I think I'd like to conclude here, but if there are any questions, I'd be happy to take.
How can technology help in managing the risk?
Yeah, okay. Technology, so one is, you know, risk and technology are sort of intertwined, you're right. Now, what is the notion of risk? The notion of risk is that if I have to, every company today, and we all see corporates, correct? Every corporate, it does well in one quarter, next quarter it has to do even better, correct? Now, let's say you have a downturn in the economy. Now, if you have a downturn in the economy, people still want you to do as well as at least the last quarter. And you need to take a higher risk then to do as well. Got it? So the whole concept of risk management becomes very, very important. That means the idea is in a downturn also I need to take risk, but I need to take risk systematically and in the right way. And that is where technology plays a big, big role. Because technology builds risk management systems. Because what do you do when you want to grow your money? You either manufacture and do things better, you take, because every company has their own money, their treasury, you either trade that or put it into the right books. If you've got it in fixed deposits, you want to move it somewhere, you want to buy it, a share, whatever is allowed by your governance within the company. And you need to manage all of this very well. And so risk management is actually driven almost entirely by technology in large good corporations. Now, in many corporations, they have technology, but then things happen outside of technology. You cannot stop that. That means fundamentally, somebody has the technology, but the owner wants to do something else. He wants to keep it outside of the records. No risk management system will be able to stop that. But if you have risk management and you have full transparency and full digitization within your corporation, then risk management would be a strong play for technology. Yeah.
About Bitcoins, do you think whether they are
actually
reality or is it another market bubble?
Excellent point. So Bitcoin actually started Bitcoin, all of you know what Bitcoin is, correct? And Bitcoin is not started by any central bank. For example, in India, the rupee and the amount of rupee in the system is defined by the Reserve Bank of India. Similarly, Bank of England will define the pound, or the Fed will define what is the number of dollars, free floating, etc. It's not always rational, because if you look, and I'll give you a some anecdote and then come to your exact question. If you look today, the money printed is based on some principles, but people go and print much more. So for example, if you look at Japan and US today, Japan is a country that exports a lot, imports very less, saves a lot. US actually is a country that is just the reverse. It is huge imports from China, etc., etc. It has some exports and there's huge spending. And if you look at what, you know, a few years ago there was this fiscal cliff. The debt that US has is huge. But which is the bigger and better economy? The US. So it's funny. If you look by a balance sheet today, US is in huge debt. But the reason it is in huge debt is because all of us are willing to spend money on the US. Why? Everybody goes and buys US dollar. Safest place to put money. Even the Indian government, while we say that in India, you know, 20 billion of foreign investment is coming from the US. Believe me, the amount of US treasury bills and US things we buy to de-risk ourselves is much higher. So our investment in the US is much higher and they spend of our money. But that's the reality. So if I come back, why am I coming to Bitcoin? So everything that the banks do is not rational. So somebody came up with the idea that let's take out a currency. And it was with the idea of evading tax and stuff like that. Because any pain point, you come up with something new. If you look at all the startup stories, you know, the interviews at least, I don't know whether it's reality or not. When you go to a startup, they'll say, why did you start this? You know, I went to an airport and I found myself, I couldn't find this. So I said, I must fix this. Correct? Same thing with Bitcoin. So Bitcoin was started saying it was for people who wanted to evade tax. It was for people who wanted to have an alternative way of money. And it went that way. So there is a bad color to Bitcoin. But if you look what's going to happen with Bitcoin, coming to your question, and it goes back to my tulip example. So Bitcoin has started with a purpose. And it was started with a purpose to create some another alternate notion of money, which somewhere people thought is bad money because it is being used by underworld and other things. It is another way of, even in the demonetization drive, in the news, one way of people are buying bitcoins with their rupees, correct? So it did start with that way. But then, if Bitcoin, now what has happened is NASDAQ has started trading bitcoins. Now what will happen over some time? The notion of why Bitcoin exists will go away. Just like tulips. I told you, they started trading in tulips because some people really love tulips. Then it became an investment vehicle. Real estate. It started because you wanted to buy a house. Today it's no more there. You just want to make money. I'll buy a house, I don't care. I've got some money, buy a property even in Nagpur where I don't even have it even been. There are people like that. So what will happen with Bitcoin likely if it catches on? So either it will go down very soon or it will become something where there is simply mass adoption. I don't care what is the underlying principle. Because even your current financial money has, I told you the disparity in the US. They are printing bills. They are not a healthy economy if you look at it. They are healthy because we are putting all the money into US bills. But if you look at their own money, they actually spend the biggest. They borrow the most. When I say borrow, it is because or they take money from outside the most. And they have the biggest deficit in their economy. So similar things will happen. So it's not very, so even people are of the opinion that a traditional way of doing things is not so perfect. A Bitcoin way of doing things may not be so perfect. But who knows, tomorrow that could be the future. So there is, I think I can't give you a clear answer. My opinion is Bitcoin or something like Bitcoin will fail in 5 years or will become king in 10 years or even earlier.
Thank you, sir, for enlightening us with your words of wisdom and making us understand about three entities of finance, value of money over time, what we can do to increase the value of money. Further, you shared knowledge about growth curve, leverage, about time notation of money with technology, marketplace, features of finance, and the biggest finance innovation. You also talked about the three principles of finance, that is time, task, and probability. Once again, we thank you, sir, for your productive interaction.